First, a very happy Mother's Day to all of our moms and those who have been like a mom to us. In the gospel story today, Jesus says, "I will not leave you orphans," and certainly that promise is kept to us in the gift of the Eucharist, but it also comes to us in the fact that God continues to put people around us in our lives who inspire us, who encourage us to become better human beings. And maybe through their own examples of sacrificial love, they inspire us to do the same and to be an example of Christ for others. Today, we are very fortunate to have a group of people who continue to do that in our community and have done for such a long time. The example of faith and love that they show is a gift to us. And I certainly would like to invite them to come forward, the Little Sisters of the Poor, Sister Mary Cecilia. Thank you. She also brought me a big bag of cookies today, so life is very good, isn't it?
Thank you, Father.
Good morning, everyone. As Father said, I'm Sister Marie Cecilia, and with me is Mother Maria Christine. We are Little Sisters of the Poor at St. Augustine's Home. First of all, we would like to thank Father for allowing us to be with you today. And I would like to thank you for your generosity in the past and for having us again this weekend. You know, last night Father Bunky was here, and he told me, "Sister, the less you talk, the more they give." Is that right? So I told him, "Father, I will talk less if they remember what I said last year." So anybody remember what I said last year? Nobody. So I have to, yes. Right. Did you hear him? We pray, you pay. Father, 95% of your parishioners has intentional memory loss. I know you don't want to remember your part. Anyway, you know, I have a great news today. This year we are celebrating our 150 years here in Indianapolis. The Little Sisters came here in 1873, and first we were in Vermont Street in downtown area, and this time we have 95 years in downtown area, and we are now 55 years here in West 86th Street. So we thank you for your great support, because we will never reach this milestone without the support of the community. So from the very beginning of our congregation, you know, we have the same mission. We take care of the elderly poor. And we share the same vision of our mother foundry, St. John Jugan. She used to say, "Never forget that the poor are our Lord." We welcome the elderly poor into our home as we would welcome Christ himself. And we take care of them as our own families till God calls them to himself. And the care of the dying has always been the summit of our mission, and it is an ever more powerful witness to the culture of life. We keep a constant vigil with those who have entered the dying process, relieving their sufferings as much as possible and assuring them of our prayerful presence. The residents come to our home not just to wait to die. You know, we Little Sisters of the Poor, we strive each day to assist them, to help them, that they may live out fully the remaining days of their lives. We have different activities with them daily, depending on their physical capacities. And, you know, we strive to respect their dignity and to provide of their individual needs. So really, it's just like taking care of our own parents. And, you know, as Little Sisters of the Poor, we vowed our life to have one soul, one heart, one will with Christ. And our mother founder, St. John Jugan, put it together so simply, all for you, my Jesus. You know, we do everything for them, and we cannot do what we do without the support of the community. So here, this weekend, we are here to share with you our mission through your prayers and financial support. As little sisters, we do not have ongoing, trusts or endowments, and that's why we depend so much on public donation. Please keep us in your prayers and in your budgets. I would like to share with you where the praise we pray, you pay. You know, this is my second assignment as a begging sister. I used to be here in 2005 to 2012. I was stationed here in Indianapolis, and then I was always taking care of the residents. And then I was called to serve in Pittsburgh. I was only 1 year there doing the same thing with the residents in the infirmary. Just 1 year exactly, I received a call from my mother provincial, and she asked me if I can go to Mobile. And I said, where is Mobile? And then, the next thing I heard, if I can do the begging, I said, you know, Mother, I said, I can't do that. I know what begging entails to stand before people like this and to ask donation. And I excused myself. I said, Mother, they will never understand my accent. I just settled down here in Pittsburgh. I just renewed my license. And, you know, I made all the excuses I could express to her, but you can tell I didn't win. And she said, try. I said, all right, I'll try. And you know, as little sisters, when we travel, we have two suitcases, because I told her I'd try, and I told her I'll try for 3 months. So I didn't unpack one of the suitcase. I was trying. But I stayed there for 8 years and 3 months. Anyway, you know, when the first time, I dreaded every weekend, especially traveling from Alabama to the north side of Alabama, which is about 5 hours. And then we go to Mississippi, we go to Louisiana, to Florida. We have 6 dioceses to go. And driving was just really nerve-wracking for me to be on the highways. And so much more to stand at the pulpit. I was afraid driving, but I don't mind driving to California as long as I don't stand at the pulpit. Anyway, as time went by, I realized it wasn't for me, so I really dreaded the weekends. So I told my sister, you know, I'm going home. This is not for me. She said, don't go home. I'm praying for you. She said, you don't understand. Every time I stand by the pulpit, everything gets blurred. And I said, I'm just glad those microphones are not picking up my heartbeats. And she said, why don't you just tell them? We pray, you pay. She said, you can manage that. So that's why I'm telling you. Next time, all I have to do, please remember, I will put a sign here. We pray, you pay, bow. So you will pay more, all right? Anyway, you know, that fear disappeared one time when my mother superior told us, she realized the sisters were tired. That was Monday night. And then Tuesday, she said, we're going to sleep in. It means 7:30 we will be at the breakfast. And then, but Tuesday is the busiest day for me to go to a local market in Mobile. We ask for bread, we ask for produce, you know, during the week. You know what we do, we go to different businesses asking for donations in kind. So that Tuesday I was going to the market and going to the bakery, but it means I will not be there at 11 o'clock mass. I have to go to the 7:30 mass in the parish. But anyway, sleep in, I put my alarm at 6:30 in the morning. I still got up at 5, but went back to bed. The next thing I know, somebody climbed my bed. And then when I turned, it was my father. And I said, Dad, it was you? It's you? He said, yes. He was smiling. He was in a younger, he looks younger. And then, you know, when we have people who died, our loved ones, we wonder how they are doing, where they are, you know, we always wonder and we pray for them. And those, so my question was one after the other. I said, Dad, are you all right? He said, yes. Are you happy? Yes. Are you at peace? He said, yes. Have you seen Jesus yet? And he looked up, and I looked up, and I saw Jesus extended, you know. And then the two of us were looking up, and he turned to me. He asked me, are you happy? I said, no, I'm going out again to beg. And then he said, but you give it to Jesus. And the next thing I know, my alarm went off. It was 6:30. I have to get up and wondering and then rush to the 7:30 Mass. And the elevation of the Eucharist during the Mass, when I look up, something fell from my shoulder that I cannot explain. But that was the time I accept I'm a beggar. I stopped griping. I stopped, you know, it's just like there's such a special grace that came that moment, and I accept I'm begging for Jesus. I'm sharing this for you young people here because I would like you to look into your own hearts. Perhaps God is calling you to be priest, to be religious, and I assure you, you know, that is that very concrete experience that God will give us the grace to whatever he calls us to do. So I invite you to join us. You know, we will going to start a holy hour for vocation next month, every second Tuesday of the month, from 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock at night, and followed by fellowship. So I would like to invite you to come and join us and pray with us. And I would like to take this opportunity for all the people who are praying for vocation, because I know I owe you my vocation. I never planned or nor even thought I will be a religious, so much more to be a little sisters, because there was no little sister of the poor in the Philippines then. So God will show us the way, and I encourage you to pray that you may discern what God wants from you. Mother Teresa used to say, pray that you may have faith that you may love, love that you may serve, and serve that you may have peace. So thank you so much for all people praying for vocation, and we are united in praying for young people that they may discern what God wants from them. We still count on your prayers that we may have a generous and faithful perseverance for all of us priests, seminarians, the sisters, and all those in formations. We count on your prayers. Thank you so much. And for your part, the second collection will be after communion, right, Father? After communion, there will be a second collection. The ushers will be helping us to take up the second collection. And if you are not prepared to help us today, we have envelopes which you can mail to us your gifts later. And as I said last year, if you are issuing a check, make it payable to the Little Sisters of the Poor, or simply sign your name. We know how to fill in the blanks. God bless you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Father.